Good afternoon, everyone. Going to take a couple of seconds while everyone comes into the room. My name is Lauren Simpson. I'm with the SBDC, or the Small Business Development Center. So welcome. We're pleased to offer this event that you tuned into today through the Community Navigator Pilot Program and the U.S. Pan-Asian American Chamber of Commerce. So that's a new one for you guys. I'm going to share my screen right now and give you all a brief overview as to who it is that we are and what it is that we do. So again, my name is Lauren Simpson. I'm with the SBDC, or the Small Business Development Center. We're a national program with over 1,000 locations across the country. So regardless of what state or city you might be in, you should be able to get connected with a fairly local SBDC office. And you'll want to do so because we offer no-cost business advising for local small businesses. And they're at no cost to you because your tax dollars have already taken care of our fees. So you might as well partake in our resources, our free resources. That said, for the Los Angeles Network, which is the network that I represent, we have locations throughout the Los Angeles, Santa Barbara, and Ventura counties. And you can see those represented on the screen in front of you now. And then again, you'll want to get connected with one of those centers because we offer no-cost business advising. And so you're able to get connected with and experts like GB or Mike, as well as experts in marketing, business planning, you name it, we've got it. And then again, we also offer virtual trainings, free virtual trainings, much like what you've attended today, tuned into today, excuse me. And just keep in mind, we're here to help you. Go ahead and get started today by contacting us at 866-588-7232, or you can go online, smallbizla.org/new client. For those of you outside of the Los Angeles area, you can go to americassbdc.org/findyoursbdc. There we go. For the California Dream Fund, I'm sure many of you have heard about it. Please go to the URL that you see on your screen now, smallbizla.org/dreamfund. It's a micro grant program awarding grants in the amounts of $5,000 and $10,000 for brand new businesses. So again, you can get additional information by going to smallbizla.org/dreamfund. And then again, for the Community Navigator Program, here's the information in front of you, and you can check that out on our website as well. I'm gonna stop my screen share, and good afternoon, GB. Good afternoon, Mike. I'm gonna hand it over to two of you.
GB, you're muted.
Good afternoon.
Hi, GB.
Hi there. Today, we're going to talk about audit issues, how to audit-proof your business, and should you get audited, just a few tips here and there, which you may want to consider. That's the topic today, Mike.
Thank you. So with that topic, please keep the Q&A to that topic. If you raise a question regarding some other issue, in order to preserve GB's precious time, we will refer you to an SBDC advisor or your own professional tax advisor. All right, so please go ahead, GB.
Thank you. So can you see my screen?
Yes, we have.
Perfect. Audit. A lot of people dread them for the right reasons, because it is scary. It can be nerve-wracking. It can bring your skeletons out in the open. It's often people, often my clients ask me, what can trigger an audit? And there is no one thing, usually. It's a culmination of different variables that can kick in and cause an audit. The most common one could be a random audit. So this is where you can do everything right. You have all your ducks in a row. You never push the envelope. You do everything by the book. But even then, you get audited. Why? Because somebody did eeny, meeny, miny, mo, and they ended up on your name, your social, your entity, whatever it may have been. So that's one of the most common reasons. And this is where, whether it's random or not, it's still nerve-wracking, even though you know everything is A-okay. The second most common is maybe somebody filed a complaint. It could be a disgruntled employee. It could be a disgruntled stakeholder, maybe a client, maybe somebody who said, you know what, this person is doing something wrong. And if there are enough complaints, or if somebody is diligent enough to file a complaint against you, you could be asked to come in and show your work. Another common thing is maybe you're making a lot of money, or you're not making enough money, or you're taking too many deductions. So this is what a lot of times accountants refer to as the smell test. You're living in Long Beach and you're living off of a $2,000 Schedule C income. How? Let's talk about it. And maybe you have a good reason. Maybe you live with your parents. Maybe you live in a co-op. Maybe you have a high paying spouse. Maybe you have a trust fund, whatever the case may have been, but they want to check the, how the heck are you living off of $2,000? Or you're running a business in loss for last 5 years and you don't have a job. How are you living? How are you paying for expenses? Or maybe you're saying, you know what? I drive 20,000 miles a year for my business. Really? Let's talk about it. Are you in real estate? Well, no, I'm just an office employee. Well, really, how come you're driving 20,000 miles? Why? So these are some of the other things that can trigger an audit because it doesn't pass the smell test. And this is what we have to be careful of. The purpose of my presentation today is to share with you some of the pitfalls that you want to avoid, whether you're self-preparing or you have somebody preparing the tax return for you. You could have a negative Schedule C. And as long as, again, passes a smell test, you may be okay. But if you have a negative Schedule C for 5 years, we may have to reevaluate. Same thing goes for rental income. Same thing goes for even if you have a W-2 job, how are you living? And I have even read about cases where somebody tried to get away and say, yeah, I live in a trailer. I live off of the government subsidy. I don't have many expenses. Really? We looked at your Facebook page. You are socializing a lot. Where's the money coming for that stuff? Oh, my friends are paying for it. Really? You have such, again, the idea is at the end of the day, I always remind my clients in a court of law, the assumption that the Justice Department works under is that you are innocent until somebody proves you're guilty, whomsoever is suing you, the government or a civilian. In the tax court or in the tax world, you're guilty until you prove your innocence. So I always remind my clients, keep that in your mind. You're guilty. If somebody comes to check your books, somebody comes to check your stuff, you have to prove and you have to overcome their prejudice sometimes. I think many of you may have already heard me say this story, but I'll say it for any newcomers today. Sometimes, or actually one time I was representing a client in an audit and the auditor was a jerk to my client. And at the end, we had a conversation over some bourbon. And I asked him, why were you such a jerk to my client? And the reason was, GB, your client reminded me of the man with whom my wife cheated. These people are prejudiced. Forget race, forget culture, forget tattoos. People carry baggage, emotional and otherwise. And somebody may have already prejudged you based on how you look because you remind them of a family member that they just cannot stand, that did them some harm. And they have prejudged you and they're going to be hard on you. And then my clients sometimes say, well, GB, I did everything right. I will fight. Great. Here's my bill if you want me to represent you. Or you have to take time away from work or your job and your family and your social life to go and fight the good fight. And it's going to cost you. And you may win and you may still lose. So keep these things in mind as you prepare your own tax returns, as you encourage your tax preparer to push the envelope, or sometimes there are unscrupulous people in every profession. Sometimes somebody will promise you, hey, your tax preparer did this for you, I can get you a bigger refund. And maybe they can. And all they have to say to the IRS, this is what the client told me. And they have no liability. A lot of times people come to my office, hey, GB, I want you to do my taxes. Why? You have a simple return. As a good fiduciary, I'm telling you, scan your W-2 in TurboTax and you'll be done in 10 minutes. You don't need to pay me. I'll happily take your money, but why? Well, GB, if something goes wrong, I can put the blame on you. Nope, you can't. At the end of the day, unless I give you negligent or gross negligent advice, I cannot be held liable because I can just say this is what the client signed off on. It's your tax return. You consented to it. You're guilty. Now, if you want to come after me privately, after you have fought the battle with the IRS and Franchise Tax Board, maybe you can and maybe you will. But up until then, you're in the courthouse or you're in the audit with the IRS, Franchise Tax Board, EDD, or anybody else. So I'm not trying to scare you. I'm trying to forewarn you that the burden of proof is on you. You may be prejudged and you will have to prove you're innocent and it will cost you time and money. Anything you want to add, Mike, since I know you have a legal background, anything you want to add to that?
The same thing that you've said consistently. It's just document. I think Ted has said it consistently, Ted Hyatt.
Yes.
Because if you don't have documentation to prove your case, no matter if it's whatever legal situation you're in, then you're going to be in trouble.
Indeed.
You mentioned mileage. That's just one example, TV. You mentioned mileage.
Yes.
Right? You've seen that people audited because they put mileage down.
We'll talk about that today. Yes.
Yeah. Indeed. Okay.
Absolutely.
Document it. Yeah.
And this is where it's also the quality of your documentation that matters, because just because you have something on paper doesn't mean much. And also, remember, the documentation can be rejected. A lot of people don't know this, and I may or may not have shared this with you before. Even if you get a printed publication from the IRS or the instructions to the form to a tax return that you're preparing yourself, and you save that publication or that instruction to the form you're filling out, and you go to the auditor and say, hey, look, this is what you told me in your instructions, in your form, in your publication. It is not an authoritative piece of evidence. They can just say, well, it's subject to interpretation. This is what we meant. This is what you read. Your problem. This is not what we meant. To the point where I've also mentioned before, you can't even rely on tax court cases because it is not a court of equity. Mike will tell you, if you go to court and some judge rules in somebody's favor, it sets a precedent. Every other judge at that level or below has to use that as a precedent to make their ruling. This is why sometimes guilty people walk, because it takes a higher court to overrule that precedent. Mm-hmm. It doesn't exist in the tax court. A judge can rule against or for one client, and the IRS can say, hey, good for you. They can issue a revenue ruling, it's called. We disagree with the court. We will continue as we see fit. And if you have a problem with that, lawyer up and we'll see you in court, because the next judge may rule in our favor. There is no legal precedent. So you have to be careful what you document and what you rely on. And this is why sometimes the client says, well, GB, this is what you told me. Yes, this was my interpretation. This is why we call them judges. They can judge mm-hmm. a different way, and they have the power. They have the badge, the IRS, and the judge has full control. I mean, this is why, Mike, you will agree. Anytime a lawyer or somebody has to approach a judge, they have to get their permission. May I approach the bench?
Yes.
Because a judge has full control over their courtroom. So you are powerless. Mm-hmm. So this is why, even if you're documenting, the quality of your documentation, the authority of your documentation matters a lot. And if you have all that done, you can rest easy, but that doesn't mean you're off the hook. So the tax world can be very scary. And this is why we always suggest get a proper advisor, especially as your business and your personal finances are growing. TurboTax may not cut it.
The legal concept for decisions which are being followed by other judges called stare decisis.
Stare decisis, exactly.
Right. And that's an issue that's come up with the Supreme Court over many, many years.
Indeed. Indeed. And even remember, this is why even the guilty party will always lawyer up, because it's not just something that is written, it's the interpretation and the technicalities of things. And this is why sometimes people get off the hook just based on technicality. This is why you may see people say, well, that person is guilty. Maybe. But so the point, the scope of today's presentation is what you can do to put the odds in your favor. But that doesn't mean you're foolproof. If anybody ever promises you, I will give you a foolproof system, they're either lying to themselves or they're lying to you. One or the other, in my experience. So income tax audits, number one thing that they look for is the 80-20 rule. What is the 80-20 rule? That if you have something that you use for personal and business purposes, maybe a cell phone, for example, the maximum deduction you can take on that is 80%. That is what may be acceptable by the IRS. Anything beyond that, you have to prove far more seriously why you're entitled to 100% deduction. So for example, maybe you have a family plan of 5 cell phones, you, your spouse, and maybe your mom or your dad, and maybe 2 kids. Your cell phone bill is, I don't know, maybe $400 a month. Why? Because you're also financing your instrument. So of the, I see a lot of times people take 80% of the entire bill. Nope. If your kids are not working in the business, if your spouse is not working in the business, if your parent or anybody else on the fifth line is not working in your business, there's only one line you should be deducting, not 5. Plus, you have to take a look at how much am I paying for my monthly access, data and phone, and how much is my cost of the phone, because the phone is expensible, deductible. The phone itself has to be depreciated. So you may be under or overstating your taxable income by not doing proper bookkeeping. Oh, and by the way, if you only have one line, you have to determine how much of that are you using to go on YouTube to watch cat videos, and how much are you using it to do actual research, actual bona fide research, and how do you prove that? How do you prove that? So this is why the conservative estimate is 50%. And if you can prove that, listen, I only use my phone. I work 80 hours a week. I just don't have time to look at cat videos. I'm just doing my work. Okay, maybe 80%. But if you want to go beyond that, you have to keep log. Today I called this person. This was my mom's call. This was my business call. This was my call to my accountant. You have to keep a log of your cell phone, which the phone bill usually gives you. And you have to log it. Like, what was the purpose? I mean, it's a lot of work to save $30, $40 in a tax deduction. Or if you really want the 100% deduction for your line, add a 6th line and say, hey, this is my personal line. This is my business line. Any and all calls on this one is to my mom and my girlfriends and my boyfriends and my kids and anybody and everybody else. And all of these are to my clients, my accountant, my banker, my lawyer, my whatever it may be. So, and again, this is just the IRS. There are many, many agencies out there. There's CDTFA, there's EDD, there's Franchise Tax Board. And one of the recent audits that I represented my client in, my client had only taken 50% deduction for the cell phone. And the auditor and I were talking, and she said, yeah, we see a lot of times people take 60, 70, 80%, sometimes 100%. They said, by rule, we never allow more than 50%. So this is where you may want to, if you're so inclined, if it makes such a big difference, you could take 50 all across or 80. But remember, if you get audited by Franchise Tax Board, FTB, you may not be able to take more than 50%, because that is their unspoken rule that at least this one auditor told me. They will just not allow it. So be mindful who your audience is, who's auditing you, for what purposes. And you have a choice. Do you want to fight them on that tooth and nail? Or do you want to say, you know what, fine, whatever. I'll allow this if you allow that. I mean, a lot of times, and we'll talk about this a little later on, many times, if it's not a simple audit, it boils down to horse trading. Sometimes we talk to the auditor, hey, you know what, just okay, we'll yield here if you will yield here. We just want to close this audit. We want to keep the scope. I mean, there's a whole presentation I can do on how to handle an audit on your own. That's like a whole different skill set, but sometimes the horse trading, because the auditor also wants you to move on and go on to the next thing. So one of the biggest choice you will face, whether you're self-representing or hiring somebody, if you get an audit letter, is are you going to fight or flight? Because either way, it's going to cost you time and money. Anything you want to add to that, Mike?
It depends on the scope of the audit in terms of hiring help. Right. If it's a minor issue, they can easily handle. Exactly. You don't have to hire someone, but exactly. Something much more serious, bring in professional help. Don't try to do it on your own.
Correct. Especially right now, there are a lot of bad notices out there. So you may even get an audit because I mean, I have a client whom we're fighting for right now because the IRS claims they sent this client two notices. She never received them. And I trust my client. There's no reason for this person to lie, but maybe they did, maybe they didn't. Maybe USPS. I mean, I had a whole issue where I actually won an audit recently because it was an audit. We sent the auditor everything that the auditor had requested. 6 months later, we got a letter. We're ruling against you because you never provided us what we requested and you never answered our inquiries. And I said, no, but we did. And they're like, well, no, we didn't. I gave her the tracking number of the mail, the priority mail I sent. They said that was never mailed because even the USPS had lost their record. They said the package was never even submitted to them for delivery. So the auditor goes, GB, how can you claim you sent something when it was never mailed? Our saving grace was my client, my staff has saved a receipt where the USPS has scanned and given it to us that yes, they are accepting the package. If we didn't have that receipt, we would have been out of luck. But because of that, the auditor said, okay, you know what, fine. This is too much of a mess. If you yield to this, we'll close this right now. And we're like, fine, we'll yield to that with like a very small tax bill. And we moved on. But if we didn't have that one piece of paper, not only did the, and again, maybe they did receive the package, maybe they didn't, but the USPS even said we never delivered it if we didn't have that piece of paper. So be careful where you're going to fight and where you're going to take a beating and just move on.
And how you respond. Get that piece of paper. Get that signed receipt.
Exactly.
The post office box.
Exactly.
Don't rely on email.
No. In this day and age, I mean, especially after that experience last year, I am paranoid. I don't trust anybody because, not because they're bad people, because everybody's overwhelmed. Everybody is overwhelmed. So we're just adapting. We're just adapting. All right. Worker misclassification. This is another very, very big audit issue, especially right now, especially in California because of AB 5. You can fight it, especially with the IRS, sometimes with the Franchise Tax Board. But the number one thing that you have to do is make sure you have timely filed all 1099s. Because if IRS or Franchise Tax Board or EDD ever comes knocking and they say, well, you have misclassified workers, and you say, no, I have not. Oh, really? Did you file the 1099? Nope. By default, immediately, doesn't matter. The argument just ended right there. They must be W-2. And guess what? If they must be W-2, going back all of those audit years, you are now liable for all of their taxes, plus penalties, plus interest. You're going to be buried. You will not have a prayer. So at the very least, even if you're misclassifying employees, which I hope and pray you're not, but even if you are, issue the darn 1099. The deadline is by January 31st of every year, unless it falls on a holiday or a weekend, then you get one or two extra business days. Get it done. Keep track of it. Every year after struggling with clients, they will just send me a screenshot of their bank account. Oh, I paid this person X. Well, that's great. Did you pay them again? What is their name, their social, their address, their email address? Always have a W-9 before you engage in business with somebody. Because down the line, I mean, I've had clients, they say, you know what, GB, I contact this person and they're refusing to give me a W-9. Well, yeah, you've already done work with them. You already gave them $5,000. If they can get away with not paying taxes on it and stiff you, maybe those are their scruples. So always get the W. And sometimes people say, well, GB, I don't know if I will do enough business with them to warrant a 1099 or not. Well, that's the thing though, you don't know. This is why, if you know 100%, you will only do business with somebody for $100, $200 below the 600 limit, okay, fine, maybe you can get away with it. But once you get to the 300 mark, get the W, and you have the right to tell them, listen, we owe you, we will pay you, we need the W-9 before we pay you. Otherwise, we're holding on to your money safely. Don't worry about it. We need the W-9. Otherwise, we'll have to classify as a W-2, and then we need your W-4, and we'll withhold all the taxes. So be mindful. Also, beyond the 1099, because if you don't have that, game over, out of luck. Even if you have issued the 1099 properly, then you have to show that you have consistently hired everybody for that class of work as a 1099. It's not like, well, I'm hiring you, you're gonna do my, I don't know, web design. I'm gonna hire you as a W-9, a 1099, but hire you as a W-2. I'm gonna hire you as casual labor. I'm gonna hire you. You cannot have inconsistencies. You have to show that, yes, for this work in our industry, in our business, everybody has been and will be hired as a 1099. The other thing is why? The reasonable basis. Why are you hiring them? Because by default, the preference for the IRS and the EDD and the FTB is W-2 because they make more money should you hire them as a W-2. If you want to hire somebody as 1099, especially after the AB5 passage, you have to show the reasonable basis. Why is this person? Now, of course, there's an ABC test that we have talked about in previous webinars, but there, even beyond that, is it a customary practice in your industry? Is everybody doing it? This is one of those cases where we can maybe get away with, hey, everybody's doing it. Usually doesn't always fly very well, but in this case, or maybe you received a professional advice from somebody, or maybe you went through a prior audit and the auditor allowed that, so they set the precedent, or there was a court case or administrative ruling. But keep in mind, even on basis of all of that, you may still be disallowed and they may still be reclassified as W-2. And now you have a bigger battle on your hand that, hey, are you gonna fight the good fight or say, you know what? All right, fine, let's negotiate. You want 100,000, I can give you 20. Okay, it's not that easy, but don't fall prey to all these radio and TV ads. Hey, come to us, 100,000 or debt, settle for $500. More than half of all of these offers are rejected because they're frivolous. A lot of times people hire these people off of the phone calls or internet ads or phone ads or TV ads, wherever they may be. They will get their money up front. Usually it takes a year and a half to 2 years to settle this thing. And at the 2 year end, while you have paid this advisor all this money, IRS can say, nope, we're going to disallow. Any and all money that you paid is now down the drain. So this is why a lot of times frivolous negotiation tactics are employed by some advisors. You have to be mindful of that. You'll be out of money and still owe money while the interest is accruing. And you may be worse off than you if you had just settled or done something else. So negotiate if you have to. But remember, who's going to do the negotiation for you? Because it's going to cost you either time or money. Would you like to add something to it, Mike?
Well, that's a great point. It's just with independent contractors, be sure you have an independent contractor agreement in place.
Indeed. Document.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, you can have everything. But if you don't have a 1099, you're out of luck. That 1099 is crucial. Crucial. Home office. That's another big one. People like to say, oh, I work out of home and I'm going to write this off and write that off. Maybe. Maybe you do. Maybe you're entitled to it. But you have to earn it. You have to earn your home office deduction. Now, there is now a new method, not new, it's been there for maybe 5 or 6 years now, called the simplified method, where the IRS says, we will allow you up to 300 square feet of your home. Now, again, if you live in a 400 square feet condo or a studio, don't claim 300, but within reason, we will allow you up to 300 square feet, $5 per square feet, $1,500 per year deduction, no question asked. 99.99% of the time, they will not, because it's too small, they just don't want to deal with it. But if you go beyond the simplified method, then you have to prove that you have a bona fide home office. What that requires, step number one, must have exclusive use of business. Now, does that mean you cannot watch a cat video? How many people you know, maybe including yourself, who watch silly videos at work, even though you're at work? So exclusive doesn't mean 100%, but it does mean this is my place of work anything else that I do, if my kid is on a Zoom meeting or if I am watching Netflix on it, it's only because I'm taking a break or because my other TVs are done. But this is my office. The intention, the primary, the exclusive use is to do work. Not a lot of times people say, well, GB, I do work on my dining table. Sometimes I sit on my sofa. Sometimes I'm on John in my bathroom. I'm working everywhere. I should write off my entire rent. Not so fast. Exclusive use. The exclusive use of your bathroom is for bodily functions. If you're on a Zoom call on your commode, well, that's your business, but the IRS will not allow that deduction. Second proof. Great. You claim it's exclusive use. Prove it to me. Show me photos. Show me photos that this is my desk. These are my books. This is my screen. This is my laptop. This is where I close the door and I put a do not disturb sign, or in a Zoom meeting, do not enter sign. You have to have visual proof to show this person, the auditor, that yes, you have a 3,000 square feet mansion and you want to write off 1,500 square feet and everything else in between. Yes, I need a bigger office. Why? Because I have a lot of stuff. Maybe I have a law library. I have a lot of mechanics books. And I am a great mechanic and I have all these books and all these charts. I need 1,000 square feet. And this is my office. Nobody comes in when I'm working. Here I can prove it. So you have to show logbook. Yes, I'm in my office, my 1,500 square feet office, every day from 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. Then I leave for 2 hours before client meets and I come back and I'm doing some research and then I'm maybe taking a walk with my dog. Then I come back. Well, you gotta have a logbook. This is why people always say, well, I'm self-employed. I can work whenever I want to. Great. IRS requires a logbook. If you don't have it, too bad. Just because you say, oh yeah, I'm always working. Great. We don't believe you. Prove it to me. What are you accomplishing today? Really, you work 80 hours a week. You want to write off 1,500 square feet. And how much money did you make? $2,000? The heck are you doing? Maybe what you have is a hobby, not a business. Oh, now we get into the hobby loss rules, further limitations. So don't give them a chance to overrule you, because they will. By default, they will. You have to prove that you're right. And you have to show a receipt for expenses. That yes, I bought this desk for the exclusive use in my home office. I bought this rug. I bought this table lamp. And I keep it there. And this is where I have a desktop. This is why, again, call it a bias. They prefer desktops over laptops. Because, hey, it's very hard to move a desktop computer. But look, I bought this, and this is where I work. This is why I have a preference for desktop computers. It's an easier argument than your smartphone, an iPad, or a laptop. So proof. It's a burden of proof is on you. Anything you want to add to that, Mike?
I think you nailed it perfectly.
Thank you, sir.
Just be careful about keeping track of everything you're doing. Indeed. That's what it comes down to. And by the way,
yes.
if it's a nominal amount, maybe it's not worth the risk. Right?
Absolutely.
If it's a small amount of office space that you're using in your home and you're taking a large deduction against that space, that's another issue.
Correct.
You're misallocating the amount.
It's context. Context is always important. And it's, you have to be mindful of how much money you're saving, just like you said, Mike, and if it's worth it or not, because sometimes it may not be worth it. And not to mention, when you do all of that, I mean, there are other financial consequences also, because sometimes people want to buy a home and they make a lot of money, but they are aggressive with their deductions and now they can't buy the home that they want. So remember, any deductions you take will have an impact on your finances as well, long before it will have any impact on your tax bill and your tax audit.
There also may be other areas within your deductions where you want to, let's just say, be creative.
Correct.
Not, not illegal, but be creative.
Indeed.
And certain things tend to trigger audits.
Indeed.
And home office deductions tend to trigger audits.
Indeed. I always joke with my clients, a lot of people are going to business saying, hey, I want to be my own boss. Good luck. IRS will boss you. Franchise tax board will boss you. EDD will boss you. Mm-hmm. Your clients will boss you. Your employees will boss you. I mean, as a business owner, especially in the state of California, it's not a business friendly state. It's not as bad as some people make it out to be, but it is, let's be honest, California is not a business friendly state. Some other states are business friendly. So you have to know your audience, and California is employee friendly, not employer friendly. California is customer friendly, not business friendly. And this is where, if you are going to be aggressive, I always tell my clients, with all due respect, don't be stupid. So don't, I always tell them, don't pay me to save you $100 when it's going to cost you maybe $500 down the line. Yeah. It's risk management.
Right.
So, all right. Auto expenses. This is what Mike brought up earlier. This is the number one audit issue for small business owners. You can't just say, hey, I drove my car for business. Again, prove it, prove it, prove it. Logbook, doesn't matter digital or paper. You have to log every mile you drive on that car, not just the business miles. You have to put on there today's date, starting mileage, ending mileage. What was the purpose of the trip? How many miles I drove? I went to go pick up my dry cleaning. Then I went to go do my banking. Okay, dry cleaning, not deductible. Banking, maybe deductible. Then I went to go see a client. Then I went to go pick up my kid. Then I went on a date. They want you to track every mile, not just a business mile. You want that deduction? You want to pay less in taxes? You got to earn it. No free lunch. Earn it. It's the number one audit risk. Also, you need receipts and other invoices showing that it is the actual mileage. A lot of times my clients tell me, GB, I can do my own oil change. Great. Don't do it. Take your car to a shop at least once a year, because whenever you take a car in for a shop, for a tire rotation, for oil change, for whatever, any mechanical repair, they always ask you, what's the year, make, and model of your car? Great, you have a third party verification that you own that darn car. Great, what is the mileage? Because they want to know your mileage. So they input that and they check it on your odometer, because they don't want you to claim, hey, you drove my car 200 miles. No, we didn't. Your car came in and we only put on 10 miles for test drive. So when you go to a car mechanic, even for a tire rotation or oil change, they get all that information and you have a third party proof that yes, this was my starting mileage on January 1st of last year. This was my mileage this year, January 1st. So if I'm claiming 20,000 miles, look, I did drive 20,000 miles. And on those 20,000 miles, maybe 10,000 were business because of these activities and the other were personal use. All of these matter. And of course, then you have to decide if you're going to use the actual cost or the standard mileage rate. For the first year that you put that car in or any vehicle in business, you have to use standard mileage. Now, there are a few exceptions. I use my motorcycle a lot in my business. The standard mileage, I take the actual cost. But after the first year is done, then you have to decide what gives you the better deduction, actual cost or the standard mileage. And you have to save your receipts accordingly. If you're using actual cost, you have to save your gas. You have to save your repairs and all that stuff that comes along with it. But it is the number one audit risk. And a lot of times these audits are correspondence audit. You may get a letter from the IRS. Hey, you claimed 15,000 miles on your tax return. Schedule C, LLC, whatever you're doing. Prove it to us. Make copies of your log and your receipts and your invoices from a mechanic and send it to us. Because if you won't, we will assume you lied. We'll send you a tax bill plus penalties plus interest. Oh, and by the way, we may dig deeper and come check out your other deductions as well. This is how something can balloon into something major. And you have to be careful. You have to be careful. Anything you want to add to that, Mike?
No, you nailed it. Let's continue on.
So are you in a business or is it a hobby? If you're in a business, prove it to us. Prove it to us that you are in business and you are actually suffering any losses that you may be claiming to offset your W-2 income or other income. Where's your business plan? It doesn't have to be elaborate. It doesn't have to be 50 page, but you got to have some plan. We'll accept something on the back of a cocktail napkin, but we will not trust just your thoughts. Show us a business plan. I have had some auditor who say, you know what, you claim to be a business owner, but I Googled you. You're nowhere to be found. So if I cannot find you, how are your customers finding you? And you're telling me no one's talking about you, good or bad? And you're not, in this day and age, you're not doing any advertising. You don't have a website. You don't have a professional email. You're using your Hotmail from 1999. You're not such a Hotmail anymore. Where's your, you're telling me you're running a business and you're having all these losses, but you're so cheap that you won't even pay $15 to GoDaddy for a domain name? And you won't pay Google $5, $6 a month for a professional email? I don't think you're in a business. I think you're just, I don't know. I don't know what you're doing, but I don't like it. I will disallow these deductions. Where's your logbook? What are you doing? And it could be, again, the logbook could be auto mileage, home office. Like, show us you're actually doing some work, because clearly whatever you're doing ain't working. Show us. Oh, by the way, who are your clients? Well, you've been at this for 3 years. You don't have a single client? Really? And you're in a business, right? Huh. Okay. How much time do you devote to it? Because, you know, your spouse told us that my spouse is always at work. You spend 60, 70, 80 hours at the law firm, or you're an architect, or whatever the heck you're doing. How much time do you actually devote to this thing? 5 hours a week? Yeah, that sounds more like a hobby to me. And plus, you're golfing every weekend. You know, we saw your Facebook photos. Plus, you are just spending, I mean, they subpoena a lot of things. You're on your phone a lot. I mean, when the heck are you actually building this darn thing? So a lot of times people say, well, GB, I showed a loss for 3 years. I should stop. No, Uber hasn't made a dime yet in profit. A lot of companies out there are struggling. You are allowed to have a loss as long as you can prove you are at least in pursuit of profit. If your, you know, actions speak louder than words, just because you say you're a businessman or a businesswoman doesn't mean anything. Actions speak louder than words. Show us that you're actually trying to make a profit, not just, if I make something, great. If not, so be it. That's a hobby. That's not a business. We will disallow deductions. So that's one of the biggest things that they look at. And there have been plethora of court cases just on that. Do you have a business or do you have a hobby? You have a side hustle? Great. Are you just having a side hustle to make other people rich? Or are you actually trying to make a profit? That's what matters. And you have to prove it, that you are actually a business person, businessman or woman or whatever it may be. You have to prove it by your actions, by your documentation. And if you want to add to that, Mike.
Well, this is great stuff. I like the fact that auditors are doing Google searches now.
Oh, Facebook, Google. I mean,
I think that's great.
This is why sometimes they send you a letter. We will talk to third parties. They will talk to your friends and families and your employees. And if they will tell them, hey, help us, and whatever we make, we'll give you a cut. It's a referral fee.
Wow.
Because remember, at the end of the day, it's somebody's job. The more they can grill you, the better their prospect for a promotion, for a year-end bonus. It's business, it's nothing personal.
Yeah,
keep that in mind. These people have a job. I tell my clients, the IRS will never audit you. Neither will the FTB nor the EDD. They're just an institution, an individual from that institution who has a job, who has a year-end review, a quarterly review, is going to come and audit you. And they may like you, they may dislike you for whatever reason. Whatever reason. They may not like your tattoos. A lot of things. So keep that in mind. The burden of proof is on you. they have the power, they're the boss. And if they say, nope, I've even had audits where I have used the internal revenue manual saying my client is entitled to this deduction. And the auditor has said, I'm just gonna disallow it. Why? Just because. I had one auditor just 3 or 4 weeks ago at Franchise Tax Board tell me, you know what, Sonny? I'm in a retirement mode. I don't care. Her exact words. And we have to fight it. So these are individuals who may be disgruntled employees of IRS or Franchise Tax Board. Some of them don't like what they're doing. They're just biding time. So these are, again, I'll tell you this, in my experience at least, most people I've dealt with at IRS and Franchise Tax Board have been helpful. I don't want to give you the wrong impression that these are bad, mean people. Every family has bad people. Every business has bad people, however you define bad. In my experience, most of these individuals are hardworking, good people who take their job seriously. But there are some bad apples out there. And this is why we care about who gets nominated to the U.S. Supreme Court. We don't just say, well, these are well-educated people. They will be objective. There is no objectivity. We know people are subjective. Be aware of that. If you run a strip club, you will be judged. It's a stigma in our society. You still have a strip club. If you're running that, you will be prejudged, most likely. We better have everything properly documented. If you're in a certain neighborhood, you will be prejudged. If you're in a certain industry, you will. If you are taking big losses, you will be prejudged. Why? And you could be struggling. You could be actually having those losses. You, pardon my language, you could actually be stupid and people be taking advantage of you. But you know what? You have to prove it. That yes, I was stupid. I've learned my lesson and now I will do better. And this is my business plan and now I'm better. Great. Deduction allowed. So just be aware that you are powerless. And I say that with all due respect because the burden of proof is on you. So hobby or business, you have to prove at the very least, I always tell my clients, have a one-page business plan. And it's not just for audit proof. It allows you to think through your thoughts and decide what is working, what is not working in your business. And it's not like a one and done deal. I encourage my clients to revisit their business plan at least once a year, ideally once a quarter. Things are changing very rapidly. Look at inflation, look at everything else. So even forget the tax compliance and an audit that may or may not happen, you're running a business. At least a one-page business plan is necessary. 5 or 6 is ideal. Hiring family, that's another big one. Hey, GB, I'm making a lot of money. I should just hire my kid or my ex-spouse or my dad or my mom or whatever. Great, you can. Keep the money in your family. But you have to prove it's a bona fide employee-employer relationship. Otherwise, forget everything else. Forget, I have seen this happen many times in my career. Forget the audit, forget everything else. You hire a family member and you treat them special. Your other employees can sue you for nepotism and discrimination and a whole slew of other employment-related cases.
Yep.
Be careful. So again, an audit may or may not happen. Discrimination lawsuit is a much higher likelihood. So you have to prove they're a bona fide employee, that you also require them to keep timesheets. You are giving them evaluation. You are reserving the right to fire them if necessary. You have to prove that, you know what? I love my mom, but mom, you ain't cutting it. It's nothing personal. It's business. You're fired. If you don't have that reservation, you could be employment law crisis. And also, you know, you don't have a bona fide employee. Also, if somebody works for you, especially a spouse, more than 500 hours a year in your business and you're claiming them, they could be considered a partner in your business. And you may have joint ownership issues that go beyond just a tax compliance. So be also careful that how much are you hiring them for, in what capacity, 1099 or W-2. And so the 500 hour is a magic number that somebody's working for you just part-time, maybe 10 hours a week. Well, 52 weeks in a year, they take 2 weeks off. 10 hours a week, 50 weeks in a year, that's 500 hours. It's easy to meet. So that could have other legal implications. Not to mention, sometimes depending upon the entity choice that you have, you may also be on hook for workers' comp insurance. So anytime you hire family, there are tax consequences, employment relation consequences, insurance consequences. Just make sure you work with an advisor to think it through. Is the pay reasonable? Or are you just shifting money off of your tax return onto your kid's tax return or your mom and dad's tax return who may be retired? So, and this is where they may say, okay, you hired person X in your job and you're paying them, I don't know, 20 bucks an hour, and somehow your mom is doing the same job at 50 bucks an hour. Well, that's discrimination. Why? And that's unreasonable pay. That's tax shifting. Be mindful. Anything you want to add to that, Mike?
No, you nailed it. It's a pay reasonable. That also relates to owners who are under, right?
Yes, absolutely. Anybody who has more than 2% of the S-Corp, yes.
Yes.
Okay. Absolutely. Arm's length transaction. When you are dealing with family, the basic rule here is if you are self-dealing and you have a loss, you cannot deduct that loss. And we'll talk about self-dealing in just a little bit. Even at fair market value. So you could have self-dealing where you're trying to sell a property that you bought for $100,000, whatever the property may be, real estate or car or whatever, and you sell it to your brother for $70,000 because, I don't know, something bad happened, or it's a piece of land that you bought for $100,000, you were swindled, or the market changed, and now you need the cash. You sell it for $70,000 to your brother or your sister or your mom or your dad. You have a $30,000 loss. Can you deduct it? Nope, can't. Now, there are other implications for them that may be beneficial to them, but you cannot benefit from the loss. So this is why I say favor the buyer. There's a whole slew of things that come along with it. Who are considered related parties? Well, if you are running a business, your spouse is related party. Children, parent, siblings, grandparents, and grandchildren. Even if you don't get along, sometimes my clients will go, GB, I can't stand my dad or my mom or my sister or my brother. Doesn't matter. Related to you, tax loss limitations apply. But I don't like them. I haven't seen them in 20 years. Doesn't matter. You did business with them. So you do get along in some way. Follow the money. This is why I always remind my clients in the pecking order in the executive track, there's a president, vice president, all that stuff. The U.S. Treasury Secretary is above the Defense Secretary. Keep that in mind. Money is more important. U.S. Treasury Secretary is above the Department of Defense Secretary. So, and U.S. Treasury oversees the IRS. So you don't get along with them. You're doing business with them. You're making money. We want a cut of it. Oh, you lost money? That's all on you, bud. We will not allow that. So self-dealing rules are very important. Also, if you have entities that are owned by you more than 50%, directly or indirectly. So sometimes people say, well, okay, that's fine. I will start a business and I own 70%. My wife or my dad has his own business. Well, your dad is related to you. So the two businesses are considered related. So if they're doing business, you have to be extra careful. Now, if it's an actual business relationship, sometimes we can overcome these rules, especially, but if they're passive in nature, like real estate and patents and royalties and all that stuff, you don't have a prayer. But if you're actually selling stuff, goods or services, we may be able to overcome the self-dealing rules. So this is why I always tell my clients, be careful what you're doing and how you negotiate those contracts, because the exemption is to these related parties, your in-laws, uncles, aunts, nieces, and cousins, and employees. And or if you're going through a divorce or a corporate liquidation, then self-dealing rules are further suspended. But a lot of times people say, well, GB, I have a business. I will start an LLC. I'll have my office space with the LLC, and I'll have my LLC rented to my corporation. Self-dealing doesn't mean you cannot do it. There may be a legal or estate planning reason behind it, but tax-wise, we have to be careful. And I always remind my clients, whatever you do doesn't exist in a vacuum. There are multiple exposures that you have for the same transaction. So be mindful. Anything you want to add to that, Mike?
No, and we're coming close to the end of the hour. This is great stuff.
Thank you. So this is the last slide. I will take just a minute. A lot of times people say, well, should I hire somebody or should I just do this on my own? It depends. It depends how much time you have to do the research on the tax code, how much time you have to go to the actual meeting with the auditor, how much time do you have to follow up with them? Because, hey, right now, IRS is only answering 20% of the phone calls. So you have to take time away to do the follow-up. How good are you at asking for things? You know, sales is not that hard. Hey, Mike, do you want to buy this? No, don't worry. Next, Lauren, do you want to buy this? No, but it's easy. Right? Asking somebody on a date is easy. Hey, I like you. Want to go for lunch or dinner? No, no problem. See you soon. But a lot of people fear that. A lot of people don't like sales. A lot of people get nervous asking somebody out. You will have to ask for a lot of things because they will give you a slew of things. We want this. We want that. We want your QuickBooks. We want your bank statements. Great. I want this. Oh, well, no, GV, I can't ask IRS anything. Of course you can. Of course you can. So you have to ask. You know, you have to ask, I'm not going to give you this. Or I want you to not look here. I'll yield here. I mean, you have to negotiate. And if you're good at negotiation or you want to get better at negotiation, by all means. But you need, for good negotiation, you need emotional intelligence. If you can channel your fear of the IRS and say, yeah, no problem, let's talk business, maybe you should self-represent. But there's a reason why no doctor or most doctors don't ever operate on their own family. They're too close. They let somebody else do it. So you want to ask yourself, how emotionally intelligent are you to handle the pressure of those notices and those calls and still run a business, still keep a job, still have a social life or a family life? The closing is be prepared. Be prepared now and fill in the gaps, because the interpretation of the tax code changes. What I may tell you today, what you may see on TikTok today, may not be valid 3 years from now when somebody is auditing you. So whatever you're doing today, you have to still check your work to make sure you fill in the gaps. That's all I have, Mike.
That was terrific. Thank you, GB. Perhaps you will discuss how to handle self-audit.
Yes.
Okay, cool. Great. So thank you, everybody, for your time, Lauren, as usual. Really appreciate it. Hope we'll be back here next week on Thursday at 1 o'clock with GB and Lauren, and hope everybody has a great time. Lauren, someone's asking how to get access to this recording. Perhaps you can put that into the chat room. All right. Thank you. Goodbye, everybody.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Lauren.